Merci beaucoup. En anglais. I am James Ehrlich. I'm founder of Regen Villages, which is a Stanford University spin-off company that I founded as a Dutch holding company. I'm nearly Dutch, except for my language and my height. But other than that, this is an urgent call to action. I'd like everyone, just for 1 minute, to take a deep breath and imagine the way you would like to live in a neighborhood that can be self-sustaining. A journey that I've been on now for over 15 years is case study research in organic and biodynamic family farming. My background is actually in video game design. So I came from a place where I was imagining worlds that made sense. My inspiration started in Northern California. I'm originally from New York City, from Manhattan, which is a fantastic place to live and grow up, but it's a very brittle environment in terms of infrastructure. I came to Northern California and came to Stanford, but before that I was in above the Golden Gate Bridge in Marin County, next to George Lucas and Skywalker Ranch, and doing some very interesting things up there in software development and games and media and technology. At the same time, I was surrounded by these amazing artisanal organic farmers, these family farmers who were growing beautiful, delicious, what I call bioavailable nutrition. And I started to learn about the work of Rudolf Steiner and this idea of celestial farming, which at the time I thought was quite esoteric, but then as I learned, it really makes perfect sense. Also the work of Buckminster Fuller. And around this time, I'll take you on a journey, also from British Columbia, the University of BC, Professor Suzanne Simard in 1997 had discovered something when her dog had fallen into an old outhouse hole, and they were digging feverishly to get this dog out of the hole. Fortunately, the dog was fine and survived, but she discovered something along the wall of this hole, which was a fibrous network, which she lovingly called the Wood Wide Web. Not the World Wide Web, but the Wood Wide Web. And what's remarkable about this is that there is, in fact, a collaborative, positive economy that exists under the forest floor that is conveying nutrients and water and sugar and all kinds of minerals and such across different species of plants and trees and cultivars. This mycorrhizal network inoculates itself into the roots of the plants and conveys up to 1,000 times more than what those roots by themselves can do. So what's also amazing about this in a farming context is that when an insect bites the leaf of a networked plant, it sends a signal of the saliva. And that then sends that signal across the whole farm, which then starts to produce these pheromones that attracts birds and wasps and other predators. So you've got the Wood Wide Web, and what I like to call the Wi-Fi network, that's attracting these predators. It's quite elegant, and it's quite magical. So at Stanford University, we study biomimetics, biomimicry. How can we mimic what Mother Earth has been doing incredibly well for 4.5 billion years? So you start to look at these patterns in nature, right? Neuron, the nerve cell, this image of London at night, a simulation of the internet, and most recently, a simulation at a cosmological scale of the universe. The patterns are striking. These are mesh networks that have cellular intelligence. There's no one central brain, and yet, it's sentient, and in the moment that it senses something, it can act and behave accordingly. And that is, by the way, 30% of our DNA is mycorrhizal. We are, in fact, coming from mushrooms. And there's a lot of really interesting, fun stories I can share with you about that, some theories, some hypothesis. I won't go too much into that right now. But I aspire into real estate development because of an urgency that I felt in this industry. That imagine if we can build neighborhoods around a digital mycorrhizal network, where for the first time we can have decentralized, regenerative, resilient, and yes, smart communities around critical life support systems. And what does that really mean, critical life support systems? Well, I love delicious food. I've had some terrific meals here in the last 2 days that I've been in Geneva. Artisanal ingredients, wonderful kitchens, fantastic. And I think that that's a really important facet to living a healthy, happy life. And this is an image of organic biodynamic agriculture. It's a non-till soil. It's highly productive on a very small piece of land that can feed hundreds of people year-round. And it's not only that it is organic and biodynamic, which are fantastic practices, but we are studying the fact that it is, in fact, more bioavailable, that the nutrition is a higher frequency than what you would get otherwise from even a local farmer's market. In other words, if it has to travel even 1 kilometer, then you've already start to lose the nutritional value. For winter growth, we've been working on a lot of really interesting and exciting pieces of the puzzle in terms of full circular farming year-round. Part of this is aquaponics. It's not hydroponics, it's aquaponics. So these are fish tanks with different species of fish, freshwater shrimp, crawfish, several species of delicious fish, and their waste is ammonia that turns from nitrites to nitrates through a very low-energy biological interaction. And then that gets fed to through effluent, through dangling roots that are just in the water. That nutrient-rich water comes right back down to the fish tanks. We've saved 80% water farming like this with a 1/3 increase in yield. Just let that sink in for a minute. So vertical farming year-round supplements the soil-based farming next to the long summer season growth. Now, part of my background is software and technology, and I think that there's definitely some very exciting things happening right now in the built environment and in how we can reimagine infrastructure. So this is a map of a metabolic integration where the output of one system becomes the input of another. And for the first time in history, those previously siloed regenerative pieces of electricity, water, waste, and we throw in food, the full food basket, can actually understand each other. And their Venn overlay can learn and create some very interesting data sets. And data and technology is nothing unless it's a means to an end for our thriving, flourishing benefit. And that's, by the way, where I am now at Stanford University. I'm actually in and appointed to the School of Medicine because we're very interested in how we live and where we live to improve healthy outcomes. So as a software guy again, we have built a Village OS. The Village Operating System. And this Village Operating System looks at the infrastructure around smart house technology. So when I came to Stanford in 2012, there was this wonderful competition. You've probably heard of it, the Solar Decathlon. So I was the organic food coach for this. Aquaponic, hydroponic, for the one house solution. And about 5 minutes into my research, maybe 3 minutes, I realized that the smart house inside of a dumb neighborhood makes absolutely no sense. And we sat down with the professors and we said, you know, this is really the right way forward, that we need to be looking at infrastructure from this kind of sentient manner. And so there's connectivity, of course, to other services. So we look at, for instance, the smart house, which is lots of different platforms, LG, Bosch, Siemens, Panasonic, and then connectivity from our Village Operating System, which is a very elegant, agnostic layer of software, but also further connectivity to autonomous mobility, curriculum, healthcare, assistive robotics, right, in the neighborhood. And the complex, really, of our software is, first, that it will drive joint venture real estate developments, which I'd love to speak to folks here about that, that we can actually use the software to run those neighborhoods effectively. And the second part is to package that software up for other developers, other constructors around the world who have a pain point. And that pain point is near suburban land that's zoned for ag and ranch that can't be touched. Well, imagine if that land can have density of housing while not compromising the productive value of food, water, energy, and waste. And as a matter of fact, make it self-sustaining for the people who live in that community. And the third phase I'm really excited about, which is the software as a service for governments. Imagine changing the rules. That's the biggest issue we have right now, is changing the rules for zoning and for fast-track permitting. Now that we understand how prefab can work and make things happen quickly, we have to be able to change the rules at the government scale to make it happen even faster. So imagine this idea of a server infrastructure with the intelligence of regen villages, Village OS, learning and algorithmic improvements, then being able to be in this rule set so that governments can actually create decentralized off-grid neighborhoods without losing tax base, without losing interaction with those communities. So I've kind of front-loaded the sort of libertarian discussion in that one, I think. So from a Buckminster Fuller perspective, if folks here and know who Buckminster Fuller is, this idea of a network, sentient communities around the world, not based on arbitrary maps and lines and maps, but really about natural resources, where those communities can, for the first time, communicate with each other through the cloud and autonomously improve themselves based on where they are in a climate zone. Very much similar if you drive a Tesla, or know people who do, that the Tesla is a software platform. It's a technology that is sharing all of that information and then making that available to you when you flip on your autonomous mode. So we have a variety of very interesting pilot projects planned. As I mentioned, we are a Dutch holding company, which is separate and from my Stanford research, of course. But we are looking primarily first in North Europe for the cold weather climate context. But we have lots of different opportunities that we've been talking to governments all around the world. We just recently entered into a collaboration with Sir Robert McAlpine in the UK. They're the oldest, largest engineering construction firm in the UK. We're also discussing this opportunity for Co-op, or Coop as they're known in Sweden, and other very large groups who are building homes in an industrial scale. And what is it we're talking about? It's not Star Trek. It's about living within nature and not separate from it. We're heading to a place in human history where 75% of 10 billion people will be living in coastal megacities, completely disassociated from their natural resources. I'm sorry, but this is a recipe for disaster. There is a market, there is a trend, and it's growing steadily for people who want to have a place outside of cities. So people thought I was crazy 6 years ago with this idea of bucking this trend and going to near suburban, peri-urban, and even rural areas. But the truth is, this is proven through Blue Zone research and also parallel to my research for 15 years, that if you live in communities like this, you can live to 100, 110 years old, never seeing doctor, never taking pharmaceutical, because you have agency with your natural resources. And most importantly, you're in multi-generational, multicultural, multi-socioeconomic level neighborhoods. And that's the future from my perspective of living. As I get older, as I'm graying, I don't want to be treated like garbage. I don't want to be pushed off into senior living or assisted living. I find that to be completely perverse. We have to go back to a place in time where the wisdom and knowledge of our elders is mixing with the babies. And this lovely story, the story arc, when you walk into any eco-village, and I really recommend you do that, you go to the community center, and on the wall in the community center, there are birth notices, birthday celebrations, graduations, life celebrations, retirement celebrations, then there's hospice care and death notices. You walk into a room where you see the full story arc of life, where you are a part of it. You are connected to that cycle of life. We're really kind of detached from that, I would say, and where we are and where we're going. Also to reimagine farmland into estuaries for migrating birds, for pollinators. There's this time and place that maybe some of you or maybe all of you have experienced where you've tasted something that you didn't know was growing there before. It's a kind of pioneer growth or heirloom growth that some pollinator brought there. And it's unique and it's interesting. And we start to celebrate seasonality again, where we're that connected to our food source and to our energy source and to our life energy that's life-affirming. This is really huge. So again, imagine designing and developing neighborhoods that are all together combined in this connected natural resources, where yes, there's software, but it's a means to an end. And there's density, right? So the idea is a mix of social affordable, of condominiums, of townhomes, semi-detached. We'll talk more about that. But that two-thirds, roughly, of the land grant is productive, is permaculture, is regenerative, is life-affirming. I met last year with Jim Hackett, who's the CEO of Ford Motor. He told me within 8 years, now seven, that Ford will no longer be shipping cars with steering wheels, brake pedals, or gas pedals. And in fact, that they're not going to be selling cars to individuals or families anymore, but rather just mobility as a service. And living in Palo Alto by Stanford and in San Francisco, Ford is already very active in this autonomous full chain to the last mile, to the last meter, practically, with scooters. And so in this context, why do you need garages and why do you need driveways? It should be peripheral parking, very common to eco-villages, two-way EV communication, both charging vehicles but also using the vehicles as a battery storage system. And it starts to get really interesting and beautiful when your neighborhood is bikeable, walkable, small EV to get you from your vehicle to the front door with groceries, et cetera, where your kids can just run free out and be having a good time safely. Car culture is not the right way forward. And that even though you're in a social affordable or tiny house unit in the center of a regen village, the concept is it's an ongoing perpetual farmer's market with a built-in supermarket that absorbs our produce that we farm, but also that there's piazza kitchens and cooking and farm-to-table setups that really make being in the center of the community quite a vibrant, healthy experience. I want to add that living in regen villages, you don't have to be a farmer and you don't have to be an engineer. You buy a house, you rent a house, you pay a monthly association fee. But if you want to volunteer, if you want to be engaged in the community, then your monthly association fee can be lowered. It's a really nice way to handle intentional community issues around that topic. In terms of typologies, these are ideations, not one-to-one architectural, but I'm really compelled with wood and timber, and I just see it as the future. Prefab, warehouse built, comes to site, just like we've seen from these amazing presentations already here. It makes me so happy and honored to be here today with such esteemed colleagues, thank you so much, who are telling the story much better than I can. However, I will just say that you can live in a small unit if you have co-living space around you and access to wider community space as well. The tiny home movement is very strong and it's growing for singles, for seniors. I like to say couples in really good relationships. And the idea also of the row house, very common in Europe, twos and threes and fours. You'll notice the glazing and the greenhouse effect, that the idea is that next to as a part of each unit, even in the tiny homes and the apartments, is access to year-round delicious things that can grow right at your doorstep. Same thing, semi-detached for seniors and those with disabilities, so full services at the ground floor. And then the villa, which can also be for co-housing. And it's a quite compelling concept that people are really getting into these days, is to get a larger villa, a larger home, but have either multiple families or different individuals sharing that space. I think it's really cool. We went viral in 2016, coming out of the Venice Biennale for architecture. Did a little press release, had some, you know, Prosecco. I thought we'd get a little bump here or there. We completely hit the charts. We've had 90 million web impressions. Over 12,000 families have signed up and registered to live in Regen Village's communities, and that number increases every single day. There's an article coming out next week in the New York Times international section. It's a feature about Regen Villages. So that press, you know, coverage and viral spread is continuing. The point is that there's demand, there's interest, there's a market, there's money to be made if we can also rethink what that means to make that money, if we start to look at positive externalities and longer term payouts. So I really want to compel everyone in this room to start thinking differently about bonds, about pension fund payouts, those kinds of structures. We've got amazing technical partners, Schneider, Philips, Asahi Glass. They've all agreed to give us free stuff for our first pilot community and favored vendor status after that. But we also have our software, which is agnostic. So if we wish to switch out any of those components, we can. It's not the end of the world. But because we're born at Stanford, from the research that I did, we are connected to these wonderful universities, and there's a whole long list of universities, it's just a sample, primarily to expose and express research that needs to happen right now. And I loved your presentation about having to connect the industry with university research as science to action, but also that universities have to play a role to change the rules at a parliamentary level, at an EU level. And we've put together an amazing team of people. I won't go into the CVs, but basically we have very strong real estate development, finance, and tech. So it's a really interesting blend and marriage of folks who are working together to build Regen Villages. And we've raised some money so far from wealthy family offices in the Nordics. And we are synaptically close to really making this something that can not only be realized, but replicated and scaled globally. And here's the punchline. There's $11 trillion US dollars right now transiting from fossil fuels. They really want impact. They want to put that money into residential real estate, but they also want UN Sustainable Development Goal action. And we've published two UN SDG platform briefs, myself and two other professors at Stanford University, and primarily to tease these funds starting in 2015. At first, they ignored me. Then they sort of continued to ignore me. But then eventually, they started to see the press coverage. And what's happened now is I'm being called into these meetings with the CEOs and C-level management of pension funds, of sovereign wealth, of surplus funds, that we can put together. And I really want to compel the banks as well and those in this audience who have the ability or the connection and the influence to those who have the ability to think differently now about how we can finance the future of living through these green bonds. A residential regenerative real estate bond with asset-backed security to risk mitigation, but at the same time allows us to build these communities at scale with prefab industrial kinds of ingenuity that we've experienced here today. And I just want to end my talk a few minutes early and just say that this is urgent, if I haven't said it enough already, that we're living in really the most challenging times in our species history and planetary history, and that I really want to welcome the hopefulness in this room to awaken and inspire you to do something now because it's urgent. Thank you so much.